Welcome back to another learning series with Mr. Knight. Do you know how thick a leaf is? In fact, let me rephrase. Do you know how thin a leaf is? A leaf is very thin, but yet so powerful. A leaf is responsible to produce energy and food for most organisms in an ecosystem. We all depend on leaves for our food, whether indirectly or directly. So today we're going to talk about leaf. These thin structures, but yet so powerful for the sustenance of life. Without them, we will not be able to survive. Now let's look what is a leaf. Now a leaf is an organ found on plants that is responsible for photosynthesis and transpiration. Now this very thin organ has so many different parts. So let's look at the parts. We have at the tip right here, which we call the petiole. And the petiole is also known as the leaf stalk. At the edges of the leaf, we call those edges the leaf margin. The central part of it, which is a vein, we call it the main vein or the midrib. Branching from the midrib, we have the side veins. And the side veins, they can be different in monocot and dicot. In this leaf, which is a dicotyledon leaf, the side veins, they are branching. But in a monocotyledon, these veins will be parallel to the central vein. We also have the other portion of the leaf, which is the pretty much the entire portion, other portion of the leaf, which we call the lamina or the blade of the leaf, or we simply say leaf blade. Now the lamina is like a plastic covering. So notice, like coming from laminated. So if you look at the leaf, it's like it's covered with the plastic. So the entire portion of the leaf, we call it the lamina or the blade. And the tip of a leaf, we call that the apex. All right, so now look at the external part of the leaf. It's time to go on the inside of this very thin structure. Now imagine this thin structure has so many internal parts. This is a very amazing structure which shows you the dynamics of creation. Now, the outermost part of the leaf is called the waxicudicle, and there are two of them, the upper. You have one on the bottom and one is on the top. I'm going to talk about them in a minute. Now, below the waxicudicle, we have what I call the upper epidermis. And the upper epidermis are made of cells, which we call epidermal cells. So for exam purposes, if you see one of the cell label, then that is epidermal cell. The entire region is the upper epidermis. Below the upper epidermis, we have what I call a palisade mesophyll layer. And the palisade mesophyll layer contain palisade mesophyll cells. So one of these cells, if you see label, simple palisade mesophyll cell. So look out for those labeling. Now below the palisade mesophyll layer, you have a spongy mesophyll layer. So this mesophyll layer is below the palisade. And in the spongy mesophyll layer, you may find spongy mesophyll cells. You will see the air space, and you also have the vascular bundle. And the vascular bundle is made up of two vessels, which are the xylem and the phloem. Note for the leaf, the xylem is on the top or the uppermost part of the vascular bundle, and the phloem is at the bottom. All right, in different parts of the plant, it will be different, such as the roots and the stem. They will be organized differently. Now, below the spongy mesophyll layer, you have the lower epidermis. And in the lower epidermis, you have what they call guard cells. And the space between the guard cells, that is called a stomata. So what we're going to do now, we're going to jump into each part to talk about some functions and some descriptions. So let's do the waxicudicle first. Now, the waxy cuticle, bear in mind, is on the outermost part of a leaf, so it's a covering of a leaf, pretty much. And the waxy cuticle, as the name suggests, it is waxy, which means it provides some form of sheen. Now, this sheen will help to reduce water loss by reflecting light. So once light has been reflected from the leaf, it will reduce evaporation of water. So the leaf now can retain most of its water to make sure the plant is turgid and also to aid in photosynthesis. So it's very important for water retention in the leaf. Let's go to our next structure and let's look at the upper epidermis. Now the upper epidermis, and I'm going to look at both dermis at the same time. So the upper and the lower, they pretty much have the same function, but I'm going to mention the difference between both. Okay, and right here I'm going to make sure mention that the upper epidermis is thicker than the lower epidermis, and of course for obvious reason, because the upper epidermis is on the top, which is exposed to the direct sunlight, therefore it must be thicker to provide greater protection. So first and foremost, I want you to note right here is that the epidermis, it is the layer that separates the inside of this leaf from the external environment. So it provides, again, protection. So it protects the leaf and also aids in the reduction of water. All right, so it's protect the leaf and helps to reduce water. So it's very important in assisting the waxy cuticle. Now our next layer right here, we're going to look at the palisade mesophyll layer. And the palisade mesophyll layer is made up of palisade mesophyll cells. These cells are closely packed and elongated, and they are also photosynthetic. Okay? So very important to note is that the palisade mesophyll cells, they contain the most chloroplast. They also adapted to trap optimal sunlight. So if they contain the most chloroplast and also able to trap or absorb the most sunlight, then you can now assume or conclude that the palisade mesophyll cells are the cells where most photosynthesis will take place. All right, and because of the closeness and because they're elongated, sunlight will be difficult to pass through, hence they will absorb most of the sunlight inside of the leaf. All right, so let's go to our next structure, and our next structure right here, we're going to talk about our spongy mesophyll layer. Now our spongy mesophyll cells, which make up the spongy mesophyll layer, firstly, let's talk about them. They are spacious photosynthetic cells. So they are more spacious compared to the palisade. And in fact, they are more circular compared to the palisade. The palisade are elongated. These are circular and have more space between them. Now, the spongy mesophyll cells, they also contain chloroplast, very important. And they are adapted to allow easy diffusion of gases inside of the leaf. So because of the air space between these cells, gases can be able to diffuse easily throughout the leaves. And it's very important for carbon dioxide to reach the palisade, because remember now, the palisade cells, they are photosynthetic as well, and they have a lot of chloroplast and absorb a lot of sunlight. Hence, carbon dioxide must reach them effectively. And that is why the spongy mesophyll cells, they are spacious to allow gases, especially carbon dioxide, to reach the palisade mesophyll layer, and also to allow oxygen to diffuse out of the leaf as well. Very important. Let's look at our another structure. So the structure we're going to look at right here, it will be our vascular bundle. Now our vascular bundle, made up of transporting vessels, and the transporting vessels are xylem and phloem. Now, to make mention of the xylem is that the xylem is a dead structure. However, it contains parenchyma cells, And so I'm going to make it clear right now that the parenchyma cells, they are the only living part of the xylem. All right? Otherwise, generally, you simply say the xylem is a dead tissue or a dead vessel. Now, the xylem transport water and mineral salts. And it is very unique because if they are dead, then it'd be difficult to water to pass through the walls, right? Because if they're a living cell, water could pass through the walls by osmosis. But since they're dead, water will not pass through the walls. So think about the xylem as being like straws or water holes inside of the leaf, right? Which are made of rubber or plastic, right? And so water could pass through them easily rather than being absorbed through their walls. Because if water was absorbing through the walls, water would be difficult to stream or to cause that capillary action, all right? Now for the phloem transport plant food or organic materials, and the plant food that is being transported mainly through the phloem is sucrose. So sugar passed through the plant by the phloem in the form of sucrose. So you can make note of that. Now the phloem contains many different cells, such as the sieve tube, and the sieve tube is shown right here with these little holes inside of them. So you have the sieve tubes, you have the companion cells, you have the parenchyma, and also clarenchyma. So those are the cells of the phloem. And of course, the parenchyma, again, they are living, and this clarenchyma will aid in some support of the phloem. All right, so let's look at our another structure. And this will be our last structure. And this will be the guard cells and stomata. Now, the guard cells, they control what entering and what leaving the leaf. Okay? So they control what entering and what leaving the leaf. Now, the guard cell and the stomata, and just to make clear what is what, the guard cells are these structures around, and the stomata, so these are the guard cells right here, and the stomata is simply space between the guard cells. Now, this is where you have gaseous exchange takes place, which means gas entering and leaving the leaf, so one gas is exchanged for another, and is also the site for transpiration, which means water will leave the leaf through the stomata. Now, I want to make something very clear right here, is that during the day, most carbon dioxide will be going in while oxygen will be coming out, because the plant requires carbon dioxide to photosynthesize, and we release oxygen as a byproduct or a waste product from photosynthesis. However, if there is no light, like for example during the night, then the gas will be reversed in terms of movement. So during the night, the plant will respire more, so more oxygen will be going in, and carbon dioxide will be coming out. So just make a note of that during the day. This is the functional movement of the gases, but during the night, it is reverse of this is happening. All right, so please make mention of that. I also mentioned that water vapor will escape through the stomata. However, you will notice some water molecules here. I'm going to explain why these are like this. Now, the guard cells can be open or they can be closed. So in fact, they can go so wide and open to create an open stomata, or they can go close together to create a closed stomata. Now, when the guard cells take in water by osmosis from neighboring cells, the guard cells become turgid. So water go inside of the guard cell by osmosis, this guard cells become turgid and the stomata will be open. If water has been evaporated from the guard cells, such as in high temperatures, then the guard cells will become flaccid and the stomata will be closed. So I want to notice the difference of these water movement in and out of the guard cell. Water going in the guard cell, the stomata will be open. Water leaving the guard cells, they become flaccid and the stomata will be closed. All right, so now we're going to take one last look at our leaf structure. So this is the entire leaf, the internal parts of a leaf. And folks, remember, the leaf is very thin, but yet so powerful, and is needed to provide energy and food for organisms within an ecosystem. So now we're at the end of the lesson. So keep watching and subscribe to see upcoming lesson. See you in the next lesson.